Meanwhile, the Canadian and U.S. ambassadors met today at the annual Ontario Economic Summit in Niagara-on-the-Lake. Joining us now for his insight into the relationship between the two nations in light of the latest trade deal is Canada's ambassador to the United States, David MacNaughton. Welcome. Thank you for being with us.
Well, thank you for inviting me.
Love to get from you your take in terms of what the relationship looks like today. I interview a lot and speak to Ambassador Heyman quite frequently, and he thinks that the relationship needs to be repaired a little bit. What's your sense?
Well, there's no question that there were there's been some bruising over the last several months. I think in particular the use of the 232 national security clause or tool, if you want to call it that, on Canada was you know, rattled the relationship substantially. And the threat that the president might use it on autos was you know, something that I think Canadians just didn't expect Americans to think about or do. So I you know, the relationship is good overall, but I think that shook the confidence in the relationship, I think, fairly substantially.
And where does it stand now in terms of the interpretation of it being a national security threat in Canadian minds and also, of course, American minds?
Well, I don't think the Americans ever really considered us a national security threat. It was just one tool that the president had that he could use without having to go to Congress to impose tariffs. Usually, under normal circumstances, taxes and tariffs are the purview of Congress, and this is the one element that he's got that he can use by himself. I think I talked to many, many members of Congress who said, "Well, you know, we recognize that, you know, it's our purview, but we don't want to inhibit his leverage in the negotiations." Interestingly enough, from my perspective, the use of 232 actually made it more difficult because, you know, it was something where nobody wants to be acting when there's some kind of a threat over their heads, and so you know, it took a while for us to get to what I think is a good deal for everyone.
Okay.
But I don't think that the use of 232 is a particularly helpful negotiating tool with somebody who's a really close ally. Mm-hmm. And I hope that the Americans lift the duties on steel and aluminum sooner rather than later. We've got a successful agreement.
What are your expectations then?
I can only take the president at his word. He said he was using this as leverage in the negotiations, and that I presume now that there's successful negotiations that those tariffs will come off, and I hope they come off sooner rather than later, because we had no choice but to retaliate, and so our retaliation is hurting Americans, and even the tariffs on Canada are hurting Americans.
Right.
It's costing things, it's making things more expensive. There's an integrated supply chain, so I think that they will come to the realization that it's time to get rid of the tariffs.
What are you expecting next as it relates to the trade file?
Well, you know, we're always going to have, I mean, when you've got $2 billion a day worth of trade, there are going to be irritants here and there. But I think what we've done in the past is really channel them into various processes where, you know, they get resolved over time, and there doesn't need to be a whole lot of rhetoric around it. And sometimes we win and sometimes we don't win. But I think that's the normal course of events. I hope we get to there, because I think what signing the agreement has done is it's restored confidence, the investment climate.
Have you seen that?
Yeah, I think so. And I think the Bank of Canada commented on it yesterday. And I think it's really important, because I had individual Canadian businesses and U.S. businesses saying to me, you know, we want to make an investment, we want to do something, but we're just not sure. And I think now there's some enhanced comfort that we're back on track in terms of our relationship with the United States as far as trade is concerned. And I certainly hope that that's the case, and I do feel that that's the case.
It still has to be finalized through Congress.
Yes.
Any thoughts there, or concerns about the midterm elections coming up in a week?
You know, I have talked to Democrats and Republicans senior Democrats and senior Republicans, and well, you know, some of them have some complaints and some issues. The reality is that there's lots in the agreement for both sides to say, well, that's pretty good. It's an improvement over what we've got. Let's go ahead and do it. And the consequences of saying no mm-hmm. are really quite serious. So I think it'll get approved. It'll be up and down, and there'll be all sorts of people saying, oh, I don't know what it's going to go through. I think ultimately it's going to go through, and okay. I think that the U.S. Congress will pass it.
Ambassador, what's your take, and how do you explain it to Canadians with respect to part of the details of the deal that if Canada does a free trade deal with China, as an example, that the United States gets to look at that? And I say that in a day or a week where there are meetings in Ottawa surrounding WTO without the United States and without China, but they're in Canada, in Ottawa right now. How do you explain the different dynamics and what we could expect in terms of how much freedom, essentially, Canada has to continue to make these deals?
Well, I think what we have agreed, all three parties have agreed, is that if one of us enters into a comprehensive free trade agreement with China or another non-market economy, mm-hmm. That there are certain procedures that we're going to have to go through. I think the reality of life is, given our relationship with the United States, if we end up with a free trade deal with China, they're going to have something to say about it. I mean, it's just it will change the nature of our relationship with the United States. That doesn't mean we can't trade with China. It doesn't mean that we can't sell them LNG or agricultural products or, you know, technology or things like that. But the reality is that China is at the forefront of American minds, not just Republicans but Democrats, and so. They're our largest trading partner, United States is. We have to be sensitive to their needs. I don't see it being a huge change.
Okay.
What's going on in Ottawa in terms of the WTO is our view is that the way to deal with some of these problems in the international trading regime is to actually do it through the WTO. And there are some people that have been part of the WTO who've been resistant to any change. They've kind of been happy with the status quo. We think changes need to be made, and that's why we're trying to get groups of countries together and to convince some of the people that have been perhaps dragging their feet a little bit that the status quo is just not an option. We have to improve.
Why are they dragging their feet? What are
they resisting? I think that there are people who just say,
It's working for me.
I mean, why
isn't
should
isn't that
I?
What President Trump is criticizing?
Well, yeah,
and isn't that fair then of him to criticize that?
Well, look, there's no question that there are some improvements that need to be made to the WTO. What we're saying, however, is that the way to deal with some of the problems with China, some of the problems with other countries, is not through bilateral headbutting and tariffs, but through an improved world trading organization, which by and large has served us well, but mm-hmm. needs updating and needs improvement. And so that's what we're focused in on. And I think obviously the United States and China need to be brought to the table at some point.
Yeah.
But we're trying to build some kind of a consensus around what are the changes that need to be made that are going to improve it.
Ambassador, what's the main message in that? Because it's quite interesting, because if there isn't the WTO and President Trump continues to go down the path of bilateral trade negotiations, what's the consequence of that? And are you confident that these other countries are actually hearing what the consequences could be?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I'm not there today.
I know.
I assume that everybody realizes that it's, you know...
Well, is time of the essence? And do they understand mutually assured destruction? I suppose that's my question.
You mean between China and the U.S. or between...
Between the global trade. Because, you know, as we look at the markets down 600 points yesterday on the Dow, there is the view that we are seeing desynchronized global growth. And if we continue to go down the path of those bilateral trades and we break up these trade relationships... that could be mutually assured destruction. Maybe it's better. I don't know, but that's something.
Well, I think that the world will come to realize that having an effective international trade body is really the way to go, mm-hmm. and I think ultimately the U.S. will come to that view too. But you know, I think that the president has some legitimate concerns about the way the system operates at the present moment. One might say that he uses hyperbole on occasion in describing those, mm-hmm. but I think he's got some legitimate complaints. We understand some of them and we sympathize with them. So mm-hmm. what we're trying to do is to help build a consensus and to keep that international rules-based system that has served us all so well in place, but we've got to realize it's got to be changed, it's got to be improved.
Ambassador, during the commercial break, when you came up to the anchor desk, I said, you know, it's clearly been a very, very busy year. I haven't seen you in about a year, although I know you've been on the network, so thank you for that. What's next in terms of your agenda and how you spend your time?
Well, first priority right now is to deal with the steel and aluminum tariffs and see whether we can't get that dealt with, because I think that's an important thing to provide the certainty for both sides of the border in that regard. And then I think obviously the whole process of getting it approved is going to be important. But there are all sorts of other issues that that perhaps haven't been, as you know, in the forefront. We have security issues that we have in common with the Americans. I mean, there's all sorts of issues around cybersecurity. We have human irregular migration that's taking place. We have, you know, things going on in Venezuela and in South America and in Central America, as well as, you know, the issues in the Middle East and, mm-hmm. You know, our NATO commitments. I mean, there's an awful lot that's on the table, and a lot, and in most of these areas, we are in sync with the Americans in terms of working more closely together rather than being headbutting. So I'm looking forward to re-engaging in a positive mm-hmm. way with the Americans.
Understood. Ambassador, thank you so much for your time today. Nice to see you.
Well, it's good to be here.
Thank you.